So we can start. My name is Wandi Bruine de Bruin from the University of Leeds Center for Decision Research, and I'll be your host today. And today we're celebrating Baruch Fischhoff. Baruch, where are you? There he is. We're celebrating Baruch Fischhoff, who is the Howard Hines University Professor at Carnegie Mellon, both in the Department of Engineering and Public Policy and the Institute for Politics and Strategy. We celebrate Baruch's contribution to JDM and other fields, to policymaking, and to our personal lives. If you don't know Baruch, then you will learn today that he's a wonderful, wise, and compassionate person. In addition to being very influential in politics, academia, and and policy. Not so good with the pronunciations of things. Before we start, I want to thank Ellen Peters and Kate Wessels, the conference coordinator, for their help and advice. And I also want to thank Lisha Warfield, who is in the back of the room, filming today's session so we can make video available online. I also want to thank the co-organizers of this tribute, including Maya Bar-Hillel, who flew in all the way from Israel, just like Ruth Beyth-Marom. And I also want to thank co-organizers Anne Bostrom and Andy Parker, who, like me and others, received their PhD in working with Baruch. So today's speakers will appear roughly in chronological order, in the order that they met Baruch, with some exceptions. Few of you probably know the full life story of Baruch's life and career, so I'll give you an overview so you can follow along more easily. Baruch graduated from Detroit Public Schools, and he received his bachelor's degree in psychology and mathematics from Detroit's Wayne State University. After college, Baruch moved to Israel with Andy to work on a kibbutz, but Baruch couldn't stay away from academia, so he went to grad school at the Hebrew University of Jerusalem in 1969. He did his master's thesis with Danny Kahneman, and the main advisor on his PhD thesis was Amos Tversky. Then, in 1976, Baruch and Andy moved back to the US. Baruch worked at Decision Research in Oregon. And in 1987, he was recruited to Carnegie Mellon University by Granger Morgan, among others. One of the many things that makes Baruch so special is that he has a great passion for applying JDM research to understanding and solving real-world problems. He was one of the first to take this real-world focus in a field where it has been common to study students in the lab. Baruch has consistently taken JDM research to practitioners and policymakers. He has served on more than 30 National Academy of Sciences committees on climate change, public health, and national security. On this slide, you see Baruch testifying at a 2005 congressional briefing on pandemic preparedness. And when I asked him what he said, he responded, "Oh, I said the usual. Treat people respectfully. Give them the information they need most to make independent decisions. Don't lie, spin, or manipulate, and do the research needed to fulfill those obligations." Baruch was also the founding chair of the FDA's first Risk Communication Advisory Committee, which, among other things, led to this publicly available practical guide on how to communicate to people about health risks. It's available from the FDA website. You can download it for free. And it is one of the 12 books that Baruch has written or co-edited. And Barry DeWitt snuck into Baruch's office to take this picture. Anyone who has read Baruch's books and papers will know that Baruch is a great writer. And when Baruch is your co-author, he revises your drafts so that they say what you wanted, but only more beautifully and more concise. When Baruch originally rewrote my drafts when I was a PhD student, I thought he was just helping me with my English, because English is my second language. But then I learned he did it for everyone. And Anne Bostrom told me that her cohort of students referred to it as having their paper Baruched. And Andy Parker told me that his paper with Baruch on decision-making competence had 25 drafts before it was submitted and accepted by a journal. So in 2007, I traveled with Baruch to China and also with these lovely people. And one of the people who was with us, who was not in this picture because he took the picture, was my boyfriend at the time, who was a musician in a relatively well-known punk band, who often got recognized by fans in public. And so while we were waiting around the Chicago airport, waiting to board our flight to Beijing, someone was running up to us, who was clearly a fan, and we thought that this person was running up to the musician in our group. And he said, "I know you, I know who you are. You are Baruch Fischhoff. I read all your papers." So what you'll learn today is that Baruch has influenced a lot of people, including strangers at airports. You will hear from 10 distinguished speakers who will give rapid flash talks about Baruch. And the last speaker today is Baruch, so I hope you stay until the end. And the first speaker today is Daniel Kahneman, who is, I assume, known to you. He's Professor Emeritus in Psychology and Public Affairs at Princeton, the 2002 Nobel Prize winner in economics, and Baruch's master's thesis advisor.
That's it. Well, I never had a good memory, and it's not gotten better with time. So I have very, very few stories. And what I do have, when I think about Bauch, is emotions and adjectives, which is what people have when they lose their stories. I do remember Bauch has a sort of apparition in a very Israeli place, the psychology department at Hebrew University in 1969. He was very much as you see him today. He was tall, he was stooped, he had a gentle smile and a wry smile and a wry sense of humor. And there was about him a combination of vulnerability and strength. He seemed, you know, almost fragile. And when you got to know him, you got to know the strength. Now, there is, you know, Israel is a very diverse country, and there are many types of Israelis, and they don't resemble each other. But there was no mistaking it. Bauch was not an Israeli. He was just a very different type, a very different sort of human being, much gentler, actually, than most of us. And for some reason, he fitted the Israeli background in a remarkably close and beautiful way. And he was universally considered extremely lovable. I mean, and there was something about his gentleness and the roughness of the others, I suppose, that made that combination particularly appealing. And, you know, Bauch is one of those people that when you mention them, you smile. And, you know, there are people like that, and he's been like that always. And it's just nice to remember things about Bauch. So I have always remembered with pleasure something absurd. But it's a connection with Bauch that he inherited my daughter's crib for Maya. And that was, at the time, a significant thing. Now, the main and most obvious thing that you got to know about Bauch after a short time, he was just incredibly creative. In the flow of ideas, you would mention one idea, and then he would come up with examples, all fitting, and just a tremendous number of them, very, very quickly. I mean, there was something awesome about that creativity. You know, many of you, I mean, the older ones among you, would know that, who knew Amos, would know that Amos was not really very easily impressed. But for Bauch, he made an exception. He found Bauch awesome. And one story that I do remember, because it sort of reflects on the three of us, Amos and Bauch and myself, both did his master thesis with me, and I loved him. And he started doing his PhD thesis with me. And after a while, I told him, you'll do a lot better with Amos. And the reason I did is that when there are two people who are all over the place, that's too much. And Baruch needed some structure, needed the stability that Amos could give him and did give him. Now, you know, all of you, I'm sure, know Baruch's work. So there was that early work on hindsight by himself and with Uti, which, you know, was just brilliant. And everybody knows it and knows it for a reason. And then I'm most familiar with the work that he did after that when he was in Eugene. Many papers with Paul and with Sarah, and all of them. That was just a succession of incredible hits. I mean, everything, you know, many of us remember the findings and remember the details of the findings. And it's been a while, it's been 40 years, and the research is still fresh and compelling. I think it was Amos's idea to recommend him for the early career award of the American Psychological Association. And I remember the pride and the delight that we felt when he got it. And Baruch really has changed remarkably little. You can see that when you see the pictures. It's the same smile, it's the same gentleness, and the combination perhaps of vulnerability and strength. And he is just as lovable as he was then. Baruch.
Our next speaker is Ruth Beyth-Marom. Let's get the computer back up. Hi. Only the first slide. There you go. And what is that we're doing?
You on press this button, one?
But it will show okay. Up here. There you go.
Okay. I'm one of those tough Israelis. I'm privileged and delighted to stand here and speak about Baruch, a good friend and a mentor. I'm also very excited. I feel I'm not a person to speak about Baruch's many and important contributions to the field of psychology, policy, behavioral economics, and many more, and I'm sure that others will do that much better than me. I chose to speak about Baruch, the mensch, and his contribution to me as a cognitive psychologist, to me as an Israeli and a world citizen, and even to me as a mother and as a person. You might think this is not the appropriate place and the appropriate audience for this perspective on Baruch, but I believe that you can separate these aspects from his scientific work and achievements. To accomplish that, I'll ask each one of you during my short talk to read three multiple choice questions, and for each one of those, divide 100% probabilities between the four alternatives. So here is the first one. No. I did the arrow. Didn't work.
There you go.
This one? Okay. In 1967, Baruch came to Israel as a graduate of Socialistic Jewish Youth Movement. He settled in a kibbutz in the southern part of Israel. His job was a swine herd, a goat herd, a cow herd, or a goose herd. Think a minute and divide 100% probabilities. Baruch came to Israel in the summer of 67 after completing his BA in math. He came with Andy, his wife, to a kibbutz and lived there for about 3 years. And here is Baruch in the kibbutz. His job was a swine herd. Difficult to imagine, especially in Israel. If I asked you just to remember what was the probability you gave to this alternative, You will probably remember it higher than the estimate you actually gave a few minutes ago. This is hindsight, the concept which was introduced to the judgment and decision-making literature by Baruch. In hindsight, how come we didn't think about hindsight before? Rearing pigs didn't satisfy Baruch, and he left the kibbutz and settled in Jerusalem, joining the psychology department, where I myself just finished my BA. Both Baruch and I began our MA with Danny, and both of us continued for our PhD with Amos. Baruch was already a star. I was fortunate enough to join him in one of his hindsight studies. It was during Nixon's trips to the USSR and China. We presented to students many possible outcomes of those trips and asked them to estimate the probability of the realization. After a few months, we asked the same students to remember the estimates. And of course, hindsight was confirmed in a real-life problem. While having two great mentors, Amos and Danny, Baruch, although still a student himself of those great mentors, was a third one. And who was the fourth? Paul Slovic. They were mentors not only for me, but for all the MA and PhD students in the psychology department in those days. What did I learn? I learned a lot about how to do research, but from Baruch I also learned how to see the practical applications of the research and how important it is to study intuitions, not only in the laboratory, but also in the environment, using life events to demonstrate important phenomena. At that stage of his career, he was doing research also in real-world setting, while later on he applied this result to those settings. So here is my second question. In 1989, I spent a sabbatical in Pittsburgh with Baruch. Baruch initiated and organized a conference on a two-state solution in the Middle East, prospects and possibilities. Who of the following key heroes from the Middle East didn't join the conference? Abba Ibn, Israeli diplomat ambassador to the US, Nabil Shat, the PLO foreign minister at the time, Shimon Peres, who was the deputy prime minister at that time, Afif Safiya, then the PLO ambassador to Britain. Think for a minute and divide your probabilities. The conference he organized in 1989 was an example of Baruch's belief that psychological insights can help in solving political problems. One has to be knowledgeable in psychology as well as in political science to be able to apply behavioral insight to the Middle East conflict. You think one needs to be a bit naive to believe that such a conference might change the situation. Baruch is not naive. His initiative can be explained only by the fact that he can't be a bystander. He cares for his people as well as for all others. He can't shut his eyes. So he uses the tools he has to try and change the course of events. He doesn't sit in an ivory tower. In Israel, I have many opportunities to think about Baruch and to ask myself, what would he do in the same situation? By the way, in the list of alternative leaders who joined the 1989 conference, only Shimon Peres was absent. Probably many of you gave a high probability to this alternative, but in hindsight? So for me, Baruch is an academic mentor and a moral mentor. But he was also a mentor in the respect he pays to his children, like the respect he pays to nearly everybody. And here is my last question. In 1976, I came for a summer to Eugene to work with Paul and Baruch. Maya, Baruch's daughter, was then 5 years old. She already read fluently. Sunday morning, Maya, Baruch, Andy, and I went to the nearby park. Maya was reading a book. It got late. Andy and Baruch said that we need to go home. Maya protested. What was Baruch's response? Sitting for 15 minutes near Maya trying to convince her. Or telling her, Maya, it is getting too late. We have to go back. Sorry. 3, taking Maya's hand and holding the book in his second hand, reading her the story while she was walking, while they were walking back. 4, holding Maya in both of his hands while she continued reading. Can you imagine? I've never heard him force his opinion, use his higher status, either as a father or a teacher or a scientist. So leaving the path with Maya, his five-year-old daughter, he held her in both hands while she continued reading. He assisted Maya by creating the conditions to allow her to continue whatever she was doing here in her own way. This is the way Baruch treated his kids while they were young, and this is the way he has been treating his students. It was another lesson I learned and another contribution I got from Baruch. So for me, Baruch, and I think for many others, you are a mensch. There is no word quite like mensch in English or Hebrew. Its origin is in German language, and it means man. But it was adopted by Yiddish, Hebrew, and English with no one-word translation. The best-known additional meaning of mensch is of a person of noble character and moral. Another is a person others want to follow. For me, Baruch, you are all of those meanings and a person I try to follow. Thank you.
Thank you. That was Ruth Beyth-Marom. She flew in all the way from Israel. And the next speaker also flew in all the way from Israel. It's Maya Bar-Hillel.
I gave notice to the Fischhoff family and to the organizers that I would not be coming this year, and I was encouraged to send a video. Nowadays, in order to prepare a video, all you need is a smartphone. You don't need a technician. You can make your own video. You can then send it. But it turned out that the video I made was too heavy, so to speak, for that mail system I was using and didn't go through. And this was happening at a time where at the Hebrew University we were on a holiday break, and there were no students to ask for help, and there were no IT people to ask for help. So I couldn't send the video, which gave me a chance to look at it. And as a consequence, I'm here, as you will find out in a minute. So this is what I read to the camera after several attempts of finding myself in the privacy of my own office, completely tongue-tied. Well, this is embarrassing. Anybody who knows me even a little knows that finding words is not often my problem. I love talking. And anybody who knows me a little better than just a little, at least in the present crowd, must know that I have known Baruch for the better part of my life. I use better part of my life advisedly because my life after meeting Baruch has been better than my life before. And I dare say my friendship with Baruch had made a contribution to that. When preparing my words for this event and regretting that I will be missing it, I was flooded with memories. And that's even before I opened my old photo albums. There was Baruch and all the other Fischhoffs. In the 1960s with Amos and Danny and many others. In the 1970s in Eugene with Paul and Sarah and Roz. And in the 1980s with Robin and George and on and on. I have known Baruch for so long a time that I was there when Maya was born, and when Ilya was born, and when Noam was born. Their relationship was bequeathed to our offspring. My daughter is friends with his kids, not just Facebook friends, but the real kind. Over the years, I have met Baruch's mother, and father, and sister, and brother, and uncle, and aunt, and even his mother-in-law, and many of his friends, and his dogs. I have slept in all of Baruch's homes, and I have taken long trips in short in many of Baruch's cars. I have read most of what Baruch has written and asked him to read and help with almost all that I have written. I have eaten countless of the crackers Baruch always kept in his office drawer and eaten countless meals at the Fischhoff table. it was there that my daughter, then 20 months old, on her first visit to America, in what was to become a string of annual visits to the Fischhoffs throughout her childhood, uttered one of her first sentences in English. "Orange juice," she exclaimed excitedly. I couldn't believe my ears. "Hey, Gili," I said in Hebrew to make sure she understood what she was asking for. "How do you say orange juice in Hebrew?" With but a second's hesitation, Gili answered triumphantly, "Apple juice." I knew then she was destined to a career in translation. I have, let's face it, literally grown old with Baruch. He is a permanent fixture in my life. And yet you must all have noticed that till now I've not really said anything about Baruch. Nothing about his contributions to science, which are being celebrated today. Nothing about his profound influences on me and my work. Nothing about the kind of person he is. Not even any specific anecdotes or stories. You will have to excuse me, but the words and pictures that are running through my head are just too personal and would be too sentimental for this venue. If I get started, I will be laughing, I will be crying. It will be even more embarrassing than finding myself at a loss for words. Baruch, I will say only this. I love you. I admire you. You're immigrating to my neck of the woods with a life-changing event for me. And once you left Israel, it was a pleasure to tag behind you for decades to all the places, physical and intellectual, to which you took me. You are much more than a colleague. You are more like the brother I never had. So I look at this video and I say, then why aren't you there? If this is how you feel about it, then there's no question that you should be there. And I have to say that the look of surprise on Baruch and Andy's faces and all the other smiles I get from the many friends in this room made it completely worth it.
Next speaker is Paul Slovic, who is ready, and I am not. Where did it go? I'm working on it, no. Here we go. Paul Slovic.
Thank you. Oh, how do we get the slides going? Maybe hit the... I can see them.
We can see them. Can somebody help?
Maybe if I hit the... it's open up here. So we have a... Okay. Good. So I'll give a fast tour of my experiences with Baruch, starting in 1973. My family and I went to Israel to work with Amos and Danny, but then the October War intervened and they went off to the military. And we were left hanging around. Hebrew University was closed down, but I was introduced to Baruch by his friends, Ruti and others. And he showed me a draft of his dissertation. On hindsight, and I was kind of blown away by it. I could see immediately when I started to read this that this was one special person, a special scholar, a gift for writing, and I was very impressed. When I heard that he might be interested in coming after he finished his degree to the U.S. To work in a place like we had in Eugene. I was very excited about it, and we figured out how we could finance it. And in 1974, he came to Eugene, Oregon, to work at the Oregon Research Institute with me and Sarah Lichtenstein and others. In 1976, that institute temporarily disbanded, and we had to find another home. So Sarah, Brooke, and I founded Decision Research as a nonprofit research institute. We didn't really know what we were getting into. We didn't know that it was impossible to do something like that on soft money. And a few weeks ago, we celebrated our 40th anniversary. But I don't think we would have made it more than a few months or a few years if it hadn't been for Baruch's tremendous contributions as a scholar that very greatly satisfied our sponsors at the time and showed us that we could really do good work and find people who would sponsor that. And so 1987, after Baruch left us and went to Carnegie Mellon, he had written 114 articles. He co-authored with me and others 114 articles, which showed a tremendous productivity during that time. I think he and I were co-authors on some 40 of those articles. So he really launched Decision Research in a very solid way and enabled us to get the start we needed to keep going. So I'll just briefly mention some of the contributions you've heard. I'm sure you'll hear more about them. The hindsight bias, of course, the psychometric paradigm to study risk perception, work on risk communication, calibration of probability judgments, the lability of values, climate change work, and acceptable risk. And I'll just amplify those very quickly with just show you some of the papers. This is, of course, a famous paper, one of many he did on hindsight bias, very important work. I like this paper. These are some of my idiosyncratic hits, but I like this one for the title and as well as the topic. Brooke had many clever titles. Do those who know more also know more about how much they know? A beautiful title, very apt, and a very good paper. Knowing with certainty, very interesting result. When people said they were 100% sure of something, they were wrong about 1 in 7 times, even when they were betting on their knowledge. How safe is safe enough? This helped us launch the psychometric paradigm to study risk perception. We did many papers following up on this. And again, another good title, Lay Foibles and Expert Fables in Judgments About Risk, where we examined the difference between how experts viewed risks and how the public viewed those risks. Interestingly enough and important, 1981, Baruch was writing about climate change. I don't think anyone else in the behavioral sciences, maybe elsewhere, was trying to bring attention to the issue of climate change with this article on the psychology of CO2-induced climate change. 1981, he followed that in 1984 with another paper with Lita Furby on the psychological dimensions of climate change. So he was decades ahead of the world in calling attention to the problem and the behavioral aspects of it. Knowing what you want, measuring labile values. Again, he was in the forefront of appreciating the fact that our values are not fixed and rigid, but are very much sensitive to the contextual factors. I think this is a very important contribution to what we later called the construction of preference. Defining risk, very important, pointing out how risk is a socially constructed concept. There are many different ways to define it, and it stimulated me to later basically paraphrase what was in this book. In this article, defining risk is an exercise of power, that it makes a difference. You can define risk in different ways, and that helps, that goes a long way to defining what option in a controversial decision will come out on top. Of course, he's done a lot of work on risk perception, risk communication. I'm sure others will describe that later, including a lot of work with adolescents, trying to help show how to better educate them about the risks that they face, and also advice on sexual assault and decision theory perspectives. Very important papers. Adolescent vulnerability, the same thing. And another title that I love, The Real World, What Good Is It? Good question. And this book, in 1980 or so, the Nuclear Regulatory Commission invited us to do a book on the concept of acceptable risk, a very important concept. There was a lot of numbers being thrown around. You know, is it like one in a million additional risk for something? Is that acceptable? It was very quantitative. And we really didn't know how to address this. We were kind of daunted by this task. And Baruch saved us with a brilliant first draft of this book. And the key thing was to focus on acceptable risk as resulting from decision making, that acceptable risk is the risk associated with an acceptable decision. It's no magic number. It would depend on the situation and the characteristics of the decision. So I think 35 years later, the insights in this book are still relevant, and I think they're due to the insights that Baruch had when he helped us draft this book. So one last point, an anecdote. Baruch and I went to Warsaw in 1977 to the Sputum conference, and we played hooky one morning. We decided to go see the Warsaw ghetto, and we did that. And close by is the Jewish cemetery of Warsaw, the largest Jewish cemetery in Europe. And we started to walk through it, and this gentleman came up to us. I think he was like the caretaker, and very thrilled to see someone. No one was there. This is 1977 Soviet era. The cemetery was deserted, and he was thrilled that we were there. And he gave us like a two-hour tour of all the famous grave sites in the cemetery. And so you see they got a couple of pictures of those. And then it was time to leave, and we started to walk away. And another man came running up to us. Again, he had seen us. He was part of the cemetery, you know, caretaker group. And he was thrilled that we were there, and he invited us to his home to have something to drink. And so we went to his home, and there was the man in the middle with his son. And I was hungry. I was hoping for some milk and cookies. And he immediately brought out a bottle of vodka and glasses for me. Now, you know that Baruch is a very quick thinker. He's fast in everything he does. But this is maybe the only time I thought more quickly than him. I pointed to my stomach, and I said, ulcer. I couldn't. And Baruch didn't have an excuse. He had to take the vodka. So, man, filled the little glass, and Baruch started to sip it. You know, and he was aghast. That's not the way you drink vodka. And he just, you know, poured it down his throat. So Baruch did his best to try to imitate. I think he sipped a little faster. Got to the bottom of the glass. Put it down with a sigh of relief. No sooner had he done it that the glass was refilled. And we didn't want to be rude to this person. And so Baruch sipped again this glass. And I don't remember quite how many glasses he had to sip until we were able to kind of ease our way out. But I do remember vividly walking out of the house holding Baruch by the arm, who was rather unsteady at the time. But so thanks, Baruch, for saving me from the vodka, for enriching my life as a friend and colleague, and thanks for all you've done for the field of judgment and decision making. Thank you.
Next speaker will be Granger Morgan, once I get his slides up. There they are. There you go.
Well, it's a real pleasure to be here to celebrate my close friend and colleague, Baruch Fischhoff. Baruch joined CMU in 1987. Actually, Paul just accused me of stealing Baruch. I was the founding department head of engineering and public policy, and I was one of several folks who worked to move him, Pat Creason, I think, being another. And Baruch was the first social scientist to hold a tenure-track position in our engineering college at Carnegie Mellon, but by no means the last. Baruch's presence has contributed greatly to making the Department of Engineering and Public Policy the leading graduate program in the world that addresses problems in which technology and public, in technology and public policy in which the technical details really matter. And Baruch has sometimes explained that the interaction of social and decision science in the process of policy research and analysis often goes as follows. It's too early for social science. It's too early. Whoops, it's too late. And one of Baruch's major contributions in EPP has to been make sure that that doesn't happen in the problems that we address. Now, Baruch and I have co-authored 22 papers together. I can confirm that most of those papers got Baruched. I've always wanted to run the experiment where I have Baruch a paper and then I administer some mind-numbing drug so that he forgets and give it back to him. I would predict that the same would happen yet again. He's shaking his head, yes. But what I'm going to do with my bit of time is to talk about two big projects that we did together, the first in the area of risk communication. Now, back in the 80s, people all across government were talking about how important it was to do risk communication, but nobody really seemed to know what that meant. Everybody had ideas. And so finally, the NSF issued an RFP to do a serious piece of empirical work on risk communication. And Baruch and Lester Lave and I were very fortunate to write the winning proposal. This work resulted in considerable amounts of applied social science, 5 PhDs, and over 30 refereed publications. But at its heart, it was an engineering exercise. It was to develop a strategy that would effectively communicate about risks to people and tell them the sorts of things, the handful of things they most needed for the decisions they faced. Now, the traditional approach was you went and you got a health effects expert to tell you what they thought people ought to be told, and then you got a communications expert to packages it up for you. But if you stop to think about it, that's missing a couple of things. It ignores what people already know, and clearly, whatever you tell them, they're going to filter through their prior knowledge. And it also largely ignores what they most need to know to make decisions. So out of this came this project that led to a multi-step process of risk communication. And I'm going because Wendy tells me that I've ignored her pleas to pay attention. I'm going to skip the details of how that worked and talk about a second project that we also did together. In 1986, EPA undertook something called unfinished business. The EPA staff sat around and did an analysis. What have we not worried about? And then the Science Advisory Board did some of these. And then finally, EPA had 50 local and regional risk ranking exercises, which was really a lovely idea, but all sort of very ad hoc. And so with support from EPA, NSF, and EPRI, we developed and demonstrated a very systematic approach to doing this. Again, I'm not going to take the time to talk through it, but we invented first a hypothetical community called Centerville and a high school, and we developed risk ranking sheets. And we did this using the Slovic Fischhoff Liechtenstein risk attribute space so as to be able to get appropriate attributes across that factor space. We did a variety of things to validate. And then because the factor space only considered risks to health, safety, and the environment, and we were also interested in ecological risks, we went on and did a similar thing in the ecospace, or in the ecological space. And so we invented a whole county and did multi-attribute stuff, not just on the health and safety side, but on the ecological side. Now, to wrap up, I want to talk about two of my favorite Baruch papers. And you're all thinking, oh, he's going to talk about factor space, and he's going to talk about hindsight bias. Actually, the first one I want to talk about is a piece that Baruch did with my former doctoral student, Max Henrian. You all know about overconfidence. I mean, lay people are systematically overconfident. This is the fraction of time that in answering encyclopedia questions, people's best estimate lay outside their 90%, 98% confidence intervals. What Baruch and Max did was show that experts, physicists who were proposing best estimate values for things like the speed of light, are absolutely subject to the same problem. And so this is a lovely paper that I use all the time with my students. The second one is this paper, value elicitation, is there anything in there? And this was stimulated by Baruch's concerns about scope sensitivity, among other things. You know, the notion that I'm willing to pay as much to save one Canadian goose as a whole batch of Canadian geese. And again, this is just a lovely piece that I've enjoyed and used over and over again with my students. So thanks, Baruch, for all your great work, for your many years of friendship, and for all the fun we've had. And it's time to find something else to work on together.
Oh, I just skipped it. Our next speakers are Lisa Schwartz and Stephen Woloshin. Welcome.
Thank you. Thank you very much. It's such an honor to be here. So I don't want to get all formal, but we've been taught that it's really important to start any public presentation with a proper disclosure statement. So I'd just like to just quickly disclose that Lisa and I love Baruch. He's changed our lives. He's made us better teachers, better researchers, and better people. We met him a long time ago, back in 1995. We were still in our fellowship and training, and we were doing a project on helping women make informed decisions about screening mammography. And we came across his work in mental models, and we thought it would be really good to try to apply that in our project. We were writing our very first grant. Unfortunately, nobody at Dartmouth was doing any kind of work like that. And so we decided we would do a cold call and ask him if he would help us out. It was terrifying for us. You can imagine, you know how intimidating he is. So we called him and we told him about the project, and he was amazing and supportive and smart, and it was just wonderful. And so he told us to send the grant to him, and a few days later he wrote back to us. He said, "I've read the draft proposal quickly, but still thoroughly enough to feel that we are on the same wavelength. You wouldn't be there at Dartmouth if you weren't good at what you do, and you wouldn't be interested in our work if you didn't have outstanding taste." "This looks like an excellent opportunity to combine our fields. Let's go for it." And this was the beginning of a beautiful relationship which has lasted to this day. And I'll just quickly tell you, the mental models project was fabulous, and we learned a lot. And I'll just quickly tell you about one of the main findings. This shows the stark contrast between how the women we interviewed thought about breast cancer as this progressive, relentless, deadly disease, compared to what the experts thought. They recognized a whole series of biological trajectories, including some cases where the cancer doesn't progress or even regresses without treatment, something which is now called overdiagnosis. Now, at the time, this was a sort of a very fringe idea, and we've worked very hard to try to communicate this idea to patients, but also to clinicians. And it's been very challenging, but I'm really gratified to say that it's gone from a fringe idea to now where it's really entered into the mainstream. And in fact, here's a picture of Baruch giving the opening plenary speech at the fourth international meeting on preventing overdiagnosis just this past September in Barcelona. The other thing I want to point out, I don't know if you can read it, but in the background in the slide, these are some other things, lessons that Baruch has taught us. To be aware that of the "people are stupid" meme, to be aware of the amateurish design of vital communications, and to push back against expert despair over seemingly incompetent public. The idea is that Baruch has reminded us is that people aren't stupid, that if you tell them stuff in a complicated way, in a confusing way, they get confused. And we've adopted one of his mantras as our own. He said, from a public health perspective, one should be no more willing to expose the public to an untested message than to an untested drug. And we've taken this to heart, and really our entire careers have been about trying to communicate sometimes complex information to people in a way that's accessible and understandable. Just briefly, this is something we've been working on for years called the Drug Facts Box, which is, it's a simple table which shows the benefits and harms of prescription drugs in a way that's meant to help people make good decisions. It's something we've worked on for years, and Baruch has helped for years to try to convince FDA to adopt. They haven't done it yet. We haven't despaired, though, because we know we're in awe of the influence that Baruch has had at FDA. He's one of the major intellectual forces behind FDA's benefit-risk assessment framework, which they've recently adopted. The idea is to present to the public transparently the logic behind their approval decisions for drugs. This is one of the first ones they did for a drug called Addy, very controversial, the female Viagra. And this is a wonderful document, and it's a real advance in what FDA does.
So, in summary, Baruch has taught us how to be a real mentor and has completely changed our careers. And he's taught us about how to communicate, to remember that people are really smart and we need to respect their intelligence. If you don't want to confuse people, don't be confusing. And that it's useful messages are really hard work and you really need to test them to make sure that you're getting it right. And we have spent a long time trying to do that and having so much fun doing it with Baruch. So we can't thank you enough for what you've given us for our careers and sort of to the world in general.
Thank you, Baruch.
Our next speaker is Sarah Eggers. This is a tremendous honor to offer a tribute to Baruch, first and foremost as a student, and then as a collaborator in the policy world. I work for the Center for Drugs at the FDA. My business cards now say decision scientist, and this is a real move forward, I think, one in a very positive direction. I thought I would be the only one tonight to give the disclaimer, but mine's real. That my perspectives are mine alone and do not necessarily represent the opinions of my employer, the Food and Drug Administration. I've been learning from Baruch for over 15 years. My original goal was to address the digital divide between the haves and have-nots and do this research at Carnegie Mellon. But my project lost funding on my first day, and the Consolation Prize was a small project granted to Baruch to collate evidence on the impact of dietary supplement labeling on consumer decision-making. The project was granted by the FDA. I was completely unaware of Baruch. I knew nothing of the world of behavioral decision research, and I knew absolutely nothing about dietary supplements. I admit I was grateful for the funding, but the appeal took a while to settle in, to sink in. Now, Baruch, if I think we almost all can agree, is soothing. Even if you don't fully grasp what he is saying, it is delivered in such a soothing manner that he reassured me that this was the beginning of important work that could open the door to many other thorny issues in food and drug regulation. And he was right. This small project completely altered my path toward a field of science that I love and a regulatory world that is important. Baruch was a tremendous mentor. He pushed me when necessary, but whenever possible, he gave me space to explore the angles, draw conclusions, and express my thoughts. He was and is a champion for his students, and it always impresses me how much he continues to champion his students long after they leave Porter Hall. I didn't leave CMU as the most gifted methodologist or the most published researcher, but I was well prepared to think quickly, critically, creatively, strategically, and practically. 5 years ago, Baruch contacted me to inform me that Teresa Mullen, another CMU alum and a member of my doctoral committee,
would be contacting me about an opportunity to work within FDA on an emerging project to structure the benefit-risk assessments that guide FDA's decisions regarding the marketing authorizations of the drug products that they regulate. Brooke sent me this figure. I admit, I was grateful for the opportunity, but I confess that I thought to myself, this is it. But in his soothing way, Brooke told me that this was important work and I believed him. I went to work with Teresa and colleagues, and 5 years later, I can emphasize that yes, this is important work, and I'm grateful for that someone else has said it. And that this diagram, in its elegant simplicity, is a necessary first step in structuring and communicating FDA's decision making. At a time when the rest of the scientific and industry communities were trying to advance more quantitative methods, Baruch argued that FDA's decisions are inherently subjective, very complex, and often one-off decisions, that there are many, many decisions that FDA has to make. And the job is to first try to understand in words what the real issues are, what the nuances are, and how the experts think about those, that context in words. What Brooke understood and has imparted on me is the need for decision analysts and tool developers to truly understand the problem the decision maker is trying to address, to respect the regulatory complexities, context, and culture within which the tools must be embedded, and to leave open the door to strategically test the boundaries. His October 2015 article in Science summarizes his perspective nicely. Brooke, the work you have started has now been implemented, as we have seen in the last example. It's been implemented the review process, the first applications have been published, and our work continues to strategically test those boundaries, even today. We have, with Baruch's help, as Institute of Medicine co-chair, moved forward the dialogue on how to communicate the uncertainty in the assessment of benefits and risks. And then I continue this work, I see that it is as much or more characterizing and communicating the uncertainty that goes into those regulatory decisions as it is in trying to assess how a regulator feels about the values placed on various benefits, risks, and trade-offs. In addition to supporting the benefit risk framework, Baruch served as the founding chair of FDA's Risk Communication Advisory Committee, as Wendy has mentioned. And in the words of Lise Wanziger and Nancy Ostrow, Baruch's former colleagues in this venture, they have, quote, Baruch has guided the committee through new and unmapped types of advisory committee input with a vision of combining science and practical application. One of his direct contributions was as chief editor of the Communicating Risks and Benefits Handbook, a new type of advisory committee product at FDA, and one that could not have come to fruition without his unique combination of scientific vision and practical management, as well as his unshakable determination. Brooke is highly regarded within FDA, and all of my colleagues send their best. I'd like to end, though, with a personal thought and circle it back to my time in 2001, having just joined CMU, fresh off the farm in Iowa, never having lived in a big city. And within a month of my arrival, September 11th happened. I had $40 in my checking account. I had no credit card. I had a mom who was saying, please drive back to Iowa now. And I said, I don't want to. But it was really because I couldn't on $40. My anxiety that day will live in memory, but my anxiety was softened by knowing that I had only known Brooke for a month, but I knew that I would be taken care of no matter what happened. And in the days of ascent in my doctoral work and beyond, Brooke and Andy have opened their home. I won't say the birds have always been so welcoming, but they've opened their home for social, for mentoring, for coaching, and just showing immense care when someone shows in. What you have to say is so important, and it's the only thing that needs to be talked about for that whole afternoon, and I've spent many afternoons in Brooke's kitchen table and Andy's kitchen table, so I thank you very much, Brooke. It has been quite a ride.
presentation comes from Jen Lerner, who is not here in person, but she sent a video.
Hello to everyone at JDM. I'm sorry I'm not there with you. When you watch this, I will be in Israel giving a series of talks there. Right now I'm sitting in my office at Harvard, and I wanted to say a quick message to Baruch and really to the rest of the audience. All of you know what a profound seminal contribution Baruch has made to the field of judgment and decision making. But you may not know some of the behind-the-scenes things that I got to see being on the same faculty as him for 8 years at Carnegie Mellon. He spends an enormous amount of time counseling students. He and I co-founded the undergraduate major in decision science together, and when we were dividing up who would play which role, he said to me, "I will play the ministerial role." And as a young assistant professor, I had no idea what he was talking about. I later found out that playing the ministerial role means that he sometimes takes hours of appointments a day, meeting with undergraduates, talking with them about their life goals, understanding them as a person, as an individual, what challenges they may face, what their hopes and aspirations are. And he literally ministers to them. And it was a wonderful thing to watch, enormously inspiring. He is a man of enormous integrity and genius. And Baruch, I am honored to be part of this salute to you. Congratulations.
Thank you, Jen. We're sorry you're not here. Our next speaker is Tamar Krishnamurti. She's not using slides, but let me put something up so that the computer doesn't freeze. Let's see. How about this one?
I am absolutely thrilled and honored to be here to celebrate my mentor, my colleague, and my friend, Baruch's contributions to the field of judgment and decision making. Baruch is a maven. We've heard, and we're probably going to continue to hear tonight, of his myriad achievements as a scientist and as a thought leader. I wanted to talk about something that I think is particularly special about Baruch, that many other people think is particularly special about Baruch, and that is that Baruch Fischhoff is truly a man of the people. If there's a scientist that I know that, in the words of another woman, works tirelessly to contribute to building an America that is hopeful, inclusive, and big-hearted, it's him. I didn't really realize who Baruch was and what he'd accomplished when I wandered into his office 13 years ago. I've been applying to graduate programs in public health and dreaming big about changing the world, and I wanted to pick the brain of someone who knew about how people make decisions. And even though Baruch probably had countless responsibilities that day, exams to grade, grants to submit, like the Pentagon on line five, he was just really generous with his time. He listened, he brainstormed, he empathized, he inspired me. I learned about mental models as a potential tool to reach HIV-positive truck drivers in India that day. I left that office ready to change my life course and become a behavioral scientist, and I haven't looked back. And that's the thing about Baruch. He takes great time and care with his students. He cultivated and shaped such a unique undergraduate degree in social and decision sciences, Carnegie Mellon. He's been a mentor to many like me. His students have worked in government, industry, and academia, and nonprofit organizations, and it's a credit to his guidance and his inspiration that so many have done so well. Baruch also provides that same inspiration and guidance to military generals and, you know, senior presidential advisors, physicians, community activists. He's changing the course of policy from the top down and from the bottom up. And Baruch brings those people together. If you've been lucky enough to join one of his lovely weekend brunches or his salon-like get-togethers, it's a guarantee that you will meet a group of fascinating people, from nuclear scientists to pastors, to teens creating positive hip hop, to leading geneticists, and their interests and their rich stories will leave you feeling rejuvenated. Due to Baruch's warmth and generosity, you'll leave with about 10 different research ideas, a new collaboration, maybe a new friend. A constant presence at these gatherings is his wonderful and brilliant wife, Andy. Together, Andy and Baruch are just a powerhouse couple. And Andy's career has involved organizing many groups in need, from new moms with baby blues to children facing abuse to our refugee community in Pittsburgh. And the perspective that Andy and Baruch bring to one another is incredibly complementary. So much of the work that Baruch and I have done together, it's been Andy's relationship with local organizations that have enabled us to conduct interviews and create and evaluate interventions, not as alien outsiders, but as an integrated part of a community initiative. The academic ivory tower, I think, is very real. Behavioral science, for good or bad, has been through the ringer lately. We have fears about data dredging and rubber stamping, and in such a climate, I can say with certainty that Baruch and his incredible work is grounded in integrity and application. So I just want to quickly list a couple of the projects, and these are just a couple that I've worked on with Baruch in the last couple of years. One is My Healthy Pregnancy app, which predicts and provides resources to try and prevent preterm births. We've done foundational work for rolling out oral pre-exposure prophylaxis for HIV prevention in South Africa and Kenya. We've worked on rolling out smart metering and demand response programs in Washington, D.C. and in Maryland. So all these projects, while pushing forward basic science, have direct applications to helping improve the world. And they weren't started because they were sexy, although that doesn't mean that much of Baruch's work hasn't garnered plenty of popular press attention. The power in Baruch's approach is that he's figured out how to listen to people, how to hear from them what they need, how to give them, drawing on solid science, the tools to make the best decisions for themselves and to empower them. And that's quite a lifetime achievement. Congratulations.
Yeah. Our next speaker is Barry DeWitt. He also won't be using slides, but let's take the next picture just to look at something else.
Someone with more hair, maybe.
Let's see if I can make that happen. There we go.
Hi. So for those of you who don't know me, I'm Barry. I'm a current PhD student working with Baruch in the Department of Engineering and Public Policy. So I thought I'd just try and share a couple of quick anecdotes that give you some flavor of what it's like to be one of Baruch's doctoral students. So actually, I took an approach of mining my emails to do the research for this evening. So I went over the years of correspondence that we've had. And the first thing that was fun to revisit was something quite early on. It was one of our earliest exchanges when I had decided, after deliberating, as many of you probably have, which graduate program to attend, that I was going to attend Carnegie Mellon. And it was a bit of an embarrassing email to read. I discovered that I write extremely long emails, and I'm very happy that he doesn't seem to hold that against me. And I had forgotten that in this email I described my deliberation and sort of discovered from first principles something that I later learned is very well known, which is that if you work into judgment and decision making, you're very indecisive. But I had thought I sort of discovered this by myself. So let me just read to you a paragraph that he wrote in reply, though I haven't asked his permission to read it, but I hope he won't mind. So Baruch wrote, "You might have run across our individual differences measure of decision-making competence, done with two former graduate students, Andy Parker and Wandi Bruine de Bruin. One of our criteria for evaluating the external validity of our measure is whether more good and fewer bad things happen to people with high decision-making competence scores. As we interpret it, that correlation reflects both competence in making individual decisions and a lifetime of effective decision making, so that good decision makers face more choices where all the options have positive expectations. Such decisions are hard to make, but the decision maker can't go too far wrong. That sounds like your enviable situation, as reflected in your description of your deliberations." So reading this in retrospect, I realize it's representative of a lot of what I've come to learn. Which is one that, as lots of people have said before me tonight, that the research strives for this perfect balance between fundamental and applicable, this basic applied balance. That second, that research is almost often done collaboratively and with great collaborators. And third, that a compliment from Baruch is worth its weight in gold. So around the same time, so I had come to Baruch as an ex-math grad student, so I had no formal training in any discipline that I was embarking on, and At the time, I was doing what many in my generation seem to do in their mid-20s, which is move back home, make no money, and live off their parents while waiting for the next thing. So this is what I was doing. I had a lot of time on my hands. I was quite anxious, feeling unprepared. And I wrote to Baruch about this, and I said, you know, I have a few months. Can I prepare myself for the fall? And he sent me a reading list, and this is something I hadn't gone back to revisit in a few years. So I went back to look at it as I was doing this research. And so he included titles like Mathematical Psychology by Coombs, Dawes, and Tversky, Rifa's Decision Analysis. What I just noticed 2 weeks ago is that he didn't include a single piece of his own writing. And that was something that didn't really strike me at the time, but really strikes me now, because that type of modesty is a formative part of what it's like to work with Baruch. I think in particular, if you become a PhD student in your 20s and 30s, when you're undergoing this transition from young adulthood to slightly older young adulthood, converging on adulthood with no qualifier before it, to do that partially under his tutelage is really an amazing thing. I think any doctoral student advisor relationship is mostly about the research, mostly about the science, but with Baruch, it's really an apprenticeship, really learning how to be a responsible adult with the privileges of the education that you're getting and how to potentially be a mentor and a teacher to young people in your own future. And I think it was Ruth who said it earlier that this element is sort of inseparable from the research, and that really resonated with me. So just to end, I thought I would end with some of Ruth's words, which are more eloquent and articulate than my own, as you probably figured out by now. So this is from a later email. I had also forgotten about this. If you haven't figured it out already, Baruch is the best at email. Just not only do you get these rewritten papers, you get them at 6 a.m. the day after that you submitted them. So we had been talking about research, and this came across my eye, maybe because it resonates with me, but I think maybe some of you it will resonate for too. So Baruch wrote, well, one comment. Don't assume that people have thought of some thing. Arguably, there's particular value in pursuing things that were seemingly missed just under our noses. That status means that they're within reach of our collective, they're within our collective reach intellectually when someone succeeds in making sense or science out of them. If things are too far ahead, people can't absorb them. So I know I can only speak for myself, but I would wager maybe I can speak for others in this room when I say how grateful I am to have absorbed so much so far, and I look forward to many, many, many more years of doing that again and again. Thank you.
Our next speaker is Maya Bar-Hillel. See your slides. Here you go.
Great. So it's a pleasure to be up here speaking about one of my favorite people. And I'm representing also my brothers Noam and Ilya, who are in the audience. When we think about Baruch, we see and his life, we see several themes. And one of those is that he's someone who's always been smart and successful in kind of traditional professional terms. But he's also someone who has always had a huge commitment, an unwavering commitment to social justice and to human connection. So those are some of the themes that I want to explore today. And I think they'll be a little bit redundant with some of what you've heard already. I was kind of sitting in the audience thinking, maybe I should say something different. But from a research perspective, it's triangulation, right? You're getting the same perspective from lots of different people, and I think that speaks to Baruch's authenticity as a person. So we went through some of the family pictures. I wanted to begin with a bit of chronology, and I think Baruch's life has shaped him, and you also see kind of these characteristics that I just mentioned expressed in his life. So on the left is Baruch with his brother Marty and sister Kofi. On the right you see members of his large immigrant family, playing tug of war in the backyard. He grew up in Detroit, and despite the suits, they were a working class family with a lot of socialist background. In fact, I ran this presentation by my uncle Marty, and he said, "Is Baruch getting an award from the International Workers, you know, Socialist?" Like, you know, the wobbly, like, no. But anyway, as Marty says, it was a small house, very, very proletariat. As Baruch grew up, he became increasingly interested in social causes. So the picture on the left is one that Baruch took at a civil rights march in 1963 that he attended with some friends. He also became involved in this socialist youth movement called Hashomer Hatzair, which was oriented toward kibbutzim in Israel. So the picture on the right shows him at a youth movement camp. And Marty, my Uncle Marty, who shared the bedroom with Baruch, kind of testifies to his interests, a lot of folk music, protests, left-wing politics. Through Hashomer Hatzair, he met my mother, Andy. I think they met at age 16, which is a hard standard to live up to when you're a young person dating and kind of looking for the right person. But anyway, there they are. The picture on the right shows the family in Detroit at the wedding in Israel. And if you want a good story, ask about the honeymoon, which took place on a... Anyway, maybe I'll let Baruch speak to that. We're asking. So Baruch, it was a bus with all the relatives, and they ended up in the West Bank. Anyway, misadventures. All right, so they stayed on the kibbutz for a few years and then moved to Israel. There's Baruch teaching in Be'er Sheva, which is a town in Israel, and on the bottom left, you have me helping him write his dissertation. The bottom right, you have a sense of the home decor, so there's me cavorting in front of a picture of Karl Marx. In the 1970s, we moved to Eugene, where Baruch worked with Sarah Lichtenstein and Paul Slovic at Decision Research. So my brothers joined the picture. You have Ilya in the first two pictures, and then Noam sitting on Paul's lap. And in 1987, we moved to Pittsburgh. So got immediate family with partners on the bottom left, the parents standing in front of actually somebody else's house, but they all look identical on that block. And on the right, you've got three of Baruch's wonderful students and colleagues, Anne Bostrom, Marilyn Quadrell, and Cindy Atman. So with my remaining time, I want to return to the themes that I mentioned at the beginning and just explore them a little bit more. When we think about Baruch's life, we see three areas that he's really made a priority. And one is that issues matter. So folks have spoken about a lot of the issues he cares about. A partial list is on the left. And in his academic research, he's pursued an approach that really emphasizes engaging with real life issues. This is a quote from an interview that he gave where he was offering some advice to young academics, and it resonated with me. So he says, "Decide whether to view academic work as a job or a calling. If it is the former, then the criteria for success are clear, even if the pathway is uncertain. If it is the latter, though, then one must keep asking whether the constraints of the academic world preclude doing work that one finds meaningful, and if so, how to bend or escape them." So I think for people who are smart and successful in traditional professional terms, it's easy to just go with the flow. And I think Baruch always questions that and respects others who question it. Second theme, people matter. I think when Wendy wanted me to speak to Baruch's family life, I haven't done too much about his immediate family, but when I was consulting with my brothers, pancakes were a big theme. We spent a lot of family time making pancakes, a lot of time playing games. Baruch has always made time to talk to us if we have issues or concerns. He also provides us with editing services, which are appreciated. And Baruch and Andy have sort of a network of emotionally close and geographically far-flung friends from all stages of their lives. So here's Andy with Maya and Gili Bar-Hillel on the Oregon coast, probably in the 1970s. And when I say that people matter, I didn't even mention Baruch's research, which is obviously another area where he's sort of has staked everything on the contention that people matter. Finally, knowledge matters, but with a caveat. So Baruch wants to know how the world works, and he has a lot of interests. These are some of the books in kind of frequent rotation at our house. He values data, he values action based on evidence, but at the same time, Baruch recognizes that not every person is going to become an expert in some, you know, some academic area. He recognizes, I think this is a lesson I helped him with, that not everybody is going to be a statistical whiz. And above all, he really values a good heart. So he knows that people contribute to the world in lots of different ways and that people have different paths. So I want to close with a picture of Andy and Baruch's backyard, which is described on the right by my brother. He says, the backyard looks very overgrown, but Baruch knows what all the plants are and what's going on with them. They're native, they're deliberately chosen. Every year he knows when the grackles come back. And for me, this backyard represents the world that both of my parents, Andy and Baruch, have tried to support and the world that they believe in. And it's a world that's complex. It's not simple, you've got a lot going on. It's a world that is inclusive, that has place for everyone, or at least native species. Although, frankly, they can't recognize some stuff. So I think other stuff gets in there as well. And finally, it's a world of great beauty. So that complexity and that inclusion have a wonderful outcome. So I think that's it.
And the last speaker is this wonderful person you've been hearing about. Baruch.
Well, let me thank you all for coming and the organizers. And I must be doing something right if we have such an incredible group of people here in the room. So just let me thank you. I think the subtext of the remarks that I prepared is how grateful we are for the people who have taken us in at various times, and particularly the faculty and graduate students at the Hebrew University of Jerusalem at a time when we had just left the kibbutz, didn't know where we were going, and they created a world for us. So I thank you all, and I hope that, you know, that we have taken some other people in a reciprocal way. So it's obligatory in a situation like this to begin with an embarrassing early picture. I picked one with my wonderful and even cuter brother Marty on the left, with me wearing my favorite shirt. Actually, judging by the photographic record, it might be my only shirt. And then our father's signature writing of dates on the front of pictures. So, and our sister, the doctor, is cute too. So. One of the things I've gotten the most satisfaction from is running the decision science major that Jen and I started. This is a part of the graduating class of 2009 at the dinner for seniors at our house. And one of the things that I tell the students is that this literature that you're reading was created by people, you know, like yourselves, who contributed to it by bringing something of themselves. And you all have some unique experience, and if you choose to, you can contribute. To join us, you can contribute to the literature as well. And sometimes I'll show in class this beautiful picture of Dandi and Amos with Gili, who's appeared in a lot of the photos between us. You see these two young men, you know, who in the midst of their work, and they did this marvelous work, and by some miraculous twist of fate, they ended up as my advisors, and I just could not be more grateful. My good luck held in that I got to work with Paul and Sarah, who in some sense took me the next stage in our journey. I actually found very few pictures of us, of the three of us together. This was taken by Tibor Englander, who was a Hungarian psychologist who started the field and was a hero in his personal life. He was also, for Barry, he was also a first cousin of Paul Erdős. So if those of you who have never published in mathematics, hence don't have an can't get an Erdős number, if you publish with Paul and I, publish with somebody who's published with Tibor, you can have an Erdős number once removed. So, and somehow from Budapest, Tibor showed up in Eugene. And so did his colleague, Clara Farago, some of you may know from the last Sputum. And so you've seen this picture up before. So did Toby Page, the environmental economist, and Niels-Erik Salin, the Swedish philosopher, and Doug McLean, the American philosopher. And somehow or other to this place, this in the middle of nowhere, was the middle, upstairs from a bank in Eugene, across the street from Vips, was the center of everything. And in some ways, that characterized the field at the time, in which the field didn't quite exist, we didn't know where it was going, and people came together to share ideas in great diversity. Many of them at these meetings convened either by Ken Hammond or Ward Edwards, who in this picture are flanking Amos. So if I had any unique experiences and perspectives to bring to this field, they must have come from earlier. So as somebody mentioned, I'm a graduate of the Detroit Public Schools at a time when we had very large classes, very poorly paid teachers who were also very dedicated. We were beneficiaries of the fact that there were relatively few jobs for women at that time, and that the men who chose to teach, which was an atypical profession, were really committed to education. I went to Detroit Mumford High, which at that time had a post-Sputnik arts and science program whose accelerated math program got us as far as trigonometry in the 12th grade. Mumford was also racially integrated, unlike Verna, which gave us more exposure than we might have had otherwise to the world outside of us, including these pictures from a march down Wood, 100,000 person march down Woodard, led by Martin Luther King, that in a way was a prelude to the march on Washington. I went to Wayne State University, and looking for pictures, I was surprised to discover we had a marching band. Or at least in the 1920s had a marching band. I was, as mentioned, a math major, and there I was taken in by a young math professor named David Jonah, expert in cohomology, co-algebra. Did I get that right? And who gave me these three books. These are really classic books in their respective fields, with the underlying theme being that it was important to look at great minds grappling with fundamental issues rather than the polished retelling or, in math, the elegant proofs. And this is something I've tried to maintain in my own teaching. So I teach the basic articles, and I draw the students' attention to this footnote, say, in the Belief in Small Numbers, where you see Dandy and Amos wrestling with what it meant, what the normative standard was to determine whether or not a judgment constituted a bias. So I worked my way through college at the counter, the 4-12 shift at the counter of Great Lakes Lanes. And looking for this online, I was surprised to find this was featured online as the work of an architect, rather than for its state-of-the-art AMF pin setters, which, and so, since I've always been on the early shift and I needed early classes, I ended up taking for distribution requiring psychology, and because it has a big department, it had early classes. And one of my professors, Francine Winger, said, you know, Sam Comarita could use somebody who knows math. So Sam was discovered in his obituary, had been interned during World War II as a Japanese American, did what would now be called, was a pioneer in what now would now be called behavioral game theory, and spent his career studying what were the conditions that promoted cooperation. Sam also gave me a book, which turned me on to the field. At that point, Andy and I were convinced we were going to go live on a kibbutz for the rest of our lives, but I was admitted to the Mass Psych program at Michigan. I really wanted to meet Sam, so the faculty said, I want to meet Anatole. Said, you can meet Anatole as long as you meet our other faculty. And all the other faculty said, well, if you ever go back to school, well, we were never going back to school, but if you ever go back to school, you ought to look up this guy Tversky, who was our best graduate, and then 2 years later, Andy had the good sense to say, well, we ought to do something else. And I found this little piece of paper and almost took me in as a student. So how did we get to Israel? Well, we were part of this Zionist youth movement that Bernie Sanders was sort of engaged with at the same time, and they sent emissaries from Israel, like the Orr family from Kibbutz Betzera, who gave us what any young person wants, which is that they stood for something, and they took us seriously enough to help us figure out what we wanted to do. When we left the kibbutz, we were looking for something in the political sphere, and we were taken in by the Kahneman family. Some of the Israelis would know, the founders of a political, left-wing political dynasty in Israel, also former Detroiters. Their politics were and are to the left of ours. We found a couple of projects that were where we had common ground. So one was publishing this set of this. Israel Left, which had translations from the Hebrew press to English at a time when news was really very hard to find. If you read the text, you'll see the issues have not changed in 42 years. And we also had a discussion group, Chug Rayoni, as we called it for the Hebrew speakers, in which we studied texts that looked at the often unwitting ideological assumptions of academia. So these have been my commitments, to try to look at science, look at society. Most of the work has been done in the context of science, and every once in a while, opportunities come along to do other things. So thanks to Sarah Lichtenstein, I got to be a founding father of the Eugene Commission on the Rights of Women, one of the best political jobs I ever had, because I was expected not to show too much leadership. It led to this work. Somebody else put this up, the work we did on preventing a sexual assault with Lita Furby and Marsha Morgan, who had set up the Lane County Interagency Rape Team, one of the first of its kind. This is an area where there's been a lot more attention recently, but actually not a whole lot more research on the prevention side. As somebody mentioned, we were able to put together this meeting on a two-state solution on the Middle East, where the sessions were interesting, but I think the real work was done in the corridors of the hotel afterwards, where people who otherwise didn't have an opportunity to speak. We gave them cover to do that. Through a long-running project with Scott Atran, the anthropologist, and Bob Axelrod, the political scientist, on determinants of radicalism, I developed an interest in in how we account for civilian casualties in war zones, and we eventually led to a conference and a book that we had, where in echoing some of Paul's concerns for many years and for last year's talk, if you were here, we ended up in a sense mediating between humanitarians who are really interested in estimating the number of casualties, and humanitarians who are interested in ensuring that each person has a name and is recorded. And most of all, I've been fortunate to have the best family in the world. And fortunately, there are many other people who have the same feeling. And I probably have learned nothing as much as what I've learned from my family. And among the lessons that I've learned from thinking about my family is that attacks on the natural world and on civil society are attacks on my family, and that one needs to defend one in order to defend the other. And that I'm proud to say that my family are all engaged in the fight. I couldn't be prouder of them, and I couldn't love them more. So let me thank you for this evening, and thank you for being part of our lives.
Thank you so much. Thank you, Baruch. Thank you for the speakers. Thank you for the audience. This was wonderful. I want to ask Baruch's students to stay behind to take a picture together, because in the process of collecting pictures for this event, we found that not all of you, especially those who graduated before the cell phone era, have pictures of themselves with Baruch. So please stay behind and we'll take some pictures. Thank you all. And thank you, Baruch.